Now that we could witness the historical first flight of a real SpaceX Starship prototype with SN5 last week. What about those anomalies during the flight? And what are the next steps at Boca Chica? How does the timeline look?
Then we want to talk about Jim Bridenstine mentioning Starship,
which was really historic, about Doug and Bob praising Crew Dragon, about last week's Starlink launch, about China's lunar South Pole and near asteroid missions, and lastly about a paper suggesting that lava tubes on the Moon and Mars might be perfect for underground bases.
A lot to talk about as always, so stay tuned.
Now that the excitement of this historical moment, when Starship SN5 lifted off into the blue Boca Chica sky, has subsided a bit, people immediately start searching for stuff that didn't go so well. Oh, what's that? A flame at the Raptor engine? That's not good, not good. It certainly is a very bad sign. SpaceX has some serious issues with the Raptor, right? Oh, and what's that here during liftoff? Huge pieces of debris flying through the air. This can't be good. This can't be good. SpaceX has some serious issues there. Not good. Not good. Not good. Bad sign. Bad sign. So was that stuff really so bad? We think no. While this is still speculation and not confirmed by Elon or SpaceX yet,
there are some likely possibilities as to what could have happened. The debris flying through the air at the very beginning of SN5's takeoff procedure is probably a piece of the sand. It likely was a part of the fueling system, because we can see some additional flame right when it gets ripped off the pad. So while this wasn't perfect, it's also not super bad or a showstopper. We believe SpaceX will fix this issue for the next test flight with Starship.
The fire on Starship's Raptor engine cannot be a burning leak. If that would have been the case, SN5 would have gone boom. But since Starship didn't go boom, we suspect it might have been some flammable pieces of debris which was blasted off somewhere and by chance attached itself to the Raptor engine and being set on fire by the Raptor engine, thus still continuing to burn and giving the impression that the Raptor itself had a burning fuel leak of sorts.
So we think those issues were nothing major. And now that this giant milestone lies behind us, what can we expect next? For example, construction of the Super Heavy High Bay Assembly Building is progressing nicely, and then a new test tank is being assembled, and most notably, stacking of SN8 has begun. So then what next? Elon already said in a tweet that next we'll see several more low altitude hops, as Elon indicated, probably first with SN6, since SN5 would first have to undergo some maintenance or repair work. It will be awesome to have two hop-ready Starship prototypes. The first real flight will occur with the just mentioned SN8 though. This will be the first Starship prototype to perform high altitude flights of up to 20 kilometers, and that will also receive a nose cone and body flaps, which has been wonderfully visualized in this animation by Orbital Wedge. The time frame for this high altitude hop will be from the 18th of August this year to the 18th of February next year, because this is the time frame specified in the FCC permit which SpaceX has applied for to perform the 20 km hop. So this means there is a very good chance that we could witness the 20 km hop still this year, but until early next year at the latest. After that, we of course will have the suborbital test flights, probably in mid-2021, and hopefully the first orbital test flights together with Super Heavy in late 2021 or early 2022. Because if SpaceX really wants to send cargo starships to Mars already in 2022, they better get that orbital test flights going as soon as possible. Then they of course also have to test orbital refueling, which is an absolute key technology, which probably will also happen in 2022. Elon himself and Gwynne Shotwell have both said that if they wouldn't be able to send cargo missions to Mars in 2022 and humans to Mars in 2024, this would be a huge failure for the company. These are some extremely bold words, and we really hope they can do it. And of course, we'll also see the Dear Moon mission in 2023 and possibly a crewed moon landing in 2024 as a test for Mars, so to speak. And if you want to stay up to date not only regarding Starship and spaceflight, but also regarding other disruptive technologies, and also want to be able to vote on the topics for our Friday videos, please consider to subscribe.
The landing of Starship on the Moon will, by the way, take place with or without NASA's involvement, as Elon stated. And talking of NASA, there was this other big event not long ago, when Doug Hurley and Bob Behnken returned from the ISS aboard Crew Dragon. The following speech by Elon and Jim Bridenstine was pretty epic. And Jim Bridenstine said something which surprised us and filled us with joy. Listen to this.
And we've got to get Starship flying.
We've got to get Starship flying.
Wow, NASA not only acknowledges Starship, but now even wants Starship to succeed ASAP. Jim Bridenstine really is the best NASA administrator ever, because he seems to understand how important Starship will be for the future of human spaceflight. He really seems to get it. Then both astronauts Bob and Doug went on to praise Crew Dragon at a press conference 2 days after their return to Earth. Doug said, quote, "I personally expected there to be some, certainly not issues with the vehicle, but some challenges or some things that were maybe not quite what we expected. The mission went just like the simulators. Honestly, from start to finish, all the way, there were no surprises." He added that the vehicle's attitude control didn't even diverge from plan. "It was rock solid," he said. These are quite some words of praise. The next missions with Crew Dragon will be the Crew 1 mission, set for launch in late September, and the Crew 2 mission, set for launch in spring 2021. Maybe by that time, even Starliner will have managed to perform an uncrewed test flight.
Meanwhile, the next batch of 57 Starlink satellites has been launched into orbit last week on Thursday, increasing the number of functioning Starlink satellites to now around 600. We talked in our last week's video in more detail what this means for the Starlink beta test and why Starlink is so important in the first place. A link to the video in the description. In other news, now that China has successfully launched their own Mars mission on July 23rd, what are they planning next? Well, their big mission will be the Chang'e 5 lunar sample return mission, scheduled to launch in November this year. It will be China's first sample return mission, aiming to return at least 2 kilograms of lunar soil and rock samples back to Earth. And it will be the first lunar sample return mission since 1976, when the Soviet probe Luna 24 touched down on the moon, 4 years after the last Apollo astronauts left the moon. Currently, China already has the Chang'e 4 moon mission, which is, by the way, still ongoing. It consists of a lander and a rover and touched down on the far side of the moon on the 7th of December 2018.
The small rover U22 is still roving around on the far side of the moon, continuing to make scientific discoveries, such as a gel-like substance that has been discovered a year ago. No, not aliens, unfortunately. It is just glassy material which happens to appear gel-like, but is made out of regular moon minerals. So when Chang'e 5 sets down on the moon later this year, China will be the only nation to have working probes on the moon. Chang'e 6 will be another sample return mission, planned for 2023 or 2024. Around the same time, the Zhenghe mission will perform a sample return from a comet. So China has planned quite a lot, and is slowly but steadily working towards their ultimate goal, which is to land humans on the moon by around 2030. And thereafter, establish their own moon base. But as things are progressing now, SpaceX will have long before established a moon base with Starship.
And now research from a new paper published in the journal Earth Science Reviews aims to provide an estimate of the size of lava tubes on the moon and on Mars. We often said that underground caves or lava tubes would be a perfect spot to build Moon or Mars bases because they would offer not only easy access to underground water in the case of Mars, but also shield against cosmic and solar radiation and against meteorite impacts. Now, in order to find out how big these lava tubes are, the scientists measured the size and gathered the morphology of lunar and Martian collapse chains. These are collapsed lava tubes using digital terrain models. They even went into lava tubes on the Canary Islands themselves. But why the hell does this lava tube here look like a corridor of the alien ship from Prometheus? They then compared the Moon and Mars data to topographic studies about similar collapse chains on Earth. And the result at which they arrived is pretty mind-boggling.
They found that Mars lava tubes are 250 meters wide on average, while Moon lava tubes are 1 kilometer or even several kilometers wide due to the lower gravity, and in both cases tens of kilometers long. That is really a lot of space to build underground bases. It will be a fascinating time when the first humans start to explore the depths of these intriguing labyrinths on other worlds. What will they see? What will they find? How insane must it be to be one of those brave explorers on another world, descending down into the complete darkness into such a lava tube? And in the case of Mars, there could even be simple life deep down in the tubes and caves. For example, bacteria or even some simple sponges or ferns, which might have fled the harsh gating conditions on the surface already hundreds of millions of years ago, making all this even more exciting.
And talking about life on Mars, if you want to know how Starship could help us to find aliens, even intelligent aliens, you might want to watch this video here.
So thanks for watching the JI Space Report. And I would say, on to the future.
Picture looks fine. Everything fine.
Everything looks fine.
Thank you.
Bad sign. Bad sign.
So nice. These are some